Okay, let's do a little example of stub filter design. I want to design a maximally flat stub filter with a cutoff of 2 GHz if the filter must provide 20 dB of attenuation at 4 GHz. Let's first determine the number of elements that we need. We're going to do this using a graph. So first we need to calculate the cutoff frequency on the bottom, and the frequency where we want the attenuation on the top, that's a value of 2. Plot that right here, draw your straight line up there, and then plot 20 decibels, which is about right here, and so this is landing between 3 and 4. So we always round up, so we know that we need 4 elements of our filter. And because it's maximally flat, we're using a Butterworth table. Now let's find the normalized filter elements. So I could do either of these two designs. Again, I'm looking at Butterworth because I want a maximally flat filter, and I know that n is going to be 4, so I look at the n equal 4 line, and I could do either of these two designs. I'm going to choose to do this one today, but equally well you could do the bottom one. So we read the values off, and we can see that C1 is going to be 0.765 right here. C2 is 1.848, C3 is 1.848, and C4 is 0.765. So these are the elements that I'm going to turn into my stub filter. This is a lumped element low-pass design. Now we want to convert that to stubs. The way we convert that to stubs is here are the values that we read out of the table, and here's how they convert to stubs. So a capacitor is going to be a stub that has an impedance of 1 over the capacitance, and inductance, the stub is actually going to have the inductance, the stub impedance is going to be the same as the inductance that I read. So this is what the design could look like if I were doing a stub filter with this particular set. So each of these lines is an eighth of a wavelength long, right here, right here, right here, and right here. We have two parallel capacitors that you can see here as the blue lines, and we have two short-circuited stubs that represent inductors that are right here. Here are the two inductors, here are the two capacitors. And the black lines effectively have no length in this design. Well, this is great design, except it's not very easy to build. We'd really like to build with microstrip, and so we want to use all parallel stubs. Now in this case, because we have parallel capacitors and we're doing a low-pass design, we're going to do parallel capacitors. So we need to convert this design, the one that's right here, to all parallel capacitors. These are the inductors that we need to convert to parallel capacitors. To do this, we're going to use the Kuroda identities. Now remember, our design looked something like this. Inductor, capacitor, inductor, capacitor, inductor. So we're going to use these two top Kuroda identities in order to make our conversion. So the first thing we're going to do is begin converting this to parallel capacitors. I can always add a length of transmission line, any length of transmission line that I want, as long as it's matched to my load at the end. Everything's normalized here, so we're treating this as if the characteristic impedance of this line is 1. This line is an eighth of a wavelength long. So I can add that here, and then look how much this looks like one of my Kuroda identities. Let's take a look at those. So if I were to look at my Kuroda identities right here, this looks like this impedance, this looks like this length of line, and so I can calculate an n squared based on this. So L1, L4 is the same as Z1, and Z0 is the same as Z2, so n squared is going to be 1 plus Z2, which is Z0, which is 1, divided by Z1, which is this L4, which is right here, 0.765. And that number this is 2.3072. Okay, so the next thing that we need to do is actually do this conversion. So this is going to be my capacitor C1 is still going to be here. My inductor L2 is still going to be here. My capacitor C3 is still going to be here. And then this inductor is going to become a length of line and a capacitor. So let's call this, this is going to be n squared times z1. We'll see what that impedance will be in just a minute. And this is going to be 1 over n squared z2, and we'll see what that is. Let's just, for the sake of argument, let's give this a name. Let's call this ZA, and let's call this CA. That gives us ZA is equal to 1.765, and CA is equal to 0.4334. So we've made our first conversion. So we're happy because we have this parallel capacitor and this parallel capacitor, and we like this parallel capacitor C1 on the front, except that we've got this L2 trapped here in the center. So what we're going to need to do next is remove that. The way we're going to remove that is we're going to add a length of line over here, and that's going to be an eighth of a wavelength line, and it's going to have a characteristic impedance that matches the front of my source, and then I'm going to use the Kuroda identities to convert them. Let me show you what happens next. So we've got this design now where we've got our source, we've added a length of line that matches this, z0 is equal to 1 in this case, we've got our C1 value, we've got our L2 value, we have our C3 value, and then we have this length of line right here, which has a characteristic impedance of ZA, and we have a capacitor over here, ZA, and this is all connected to our load at the end. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to look and see which Kuroda identity this matches to. I'm going to take this combination, and that looks an awful lot like this one. So that's the Kuroda identity I will use next. So we can see that n squared, z1 in this case, is equal to z0. Our n squared changes every time we do a conversion. So we're doing a new conversion, so it has a new n squared. So n squared z1 is equal to z0, which is equal to 1. And then we've got this capacitor, which is c1, is equal to 1 over n squared z2. Now what are my z1 and z2? I can solve for them. So I can say that z1 is equal to 1 divided by n squared, and that z2 is equal to 1 divided by n squared c. Put those together down on the bottom. So now if I want to solve for n squared is going to be 1 plus z2 over z1, same as it was before, which is 1 plus 1 over n squared and 1 over n squared c. Notice that the n squares cancel out, so this ends up being 1 plus c. C is c1 in this case right here. Okay, so now I can calculate n squared, and it is equal to 1 1.765. That's what n squared is equal to in this case. So now when I do my conversion, here's my source, and this is going to turn into an inductor in series, and then a length of line, and then that's going to become, this part's going to convert here. I'm going to leave my L2, and I'm going to leave my C3, and I'm going to leave my ZA, length of transmission line, connected to CA, and then all connected to 1, like this. And this value is going to be Z1 and Z2. So calculating those, Z1 is equal to this, and Z2 is equal to this. So I'm using these equations right here. And so Z1 is 0.5666, Z2 is 0.7406. So I've made a conversion, but you might think this is worse, because now I have two series inductors. However, in the next step, what we're going to do is combine those two and use the Kuroda identity, and then we're going to add another length of line out here in the front, and we'll combine it with this inductor for our final identity. So let's go to the next page. just realizing that I want to be able to keep track of my numbers a little bit better, I am going to call this one ZB, and I'm going to call this one LB. Let's call this LB. Okay, so that's what I've got so far. Let's go to the next page. Okay, so we're ready to make this conversion now. So what I'm going to do is take this inductor and length of a line, and let's see what that looks like in the Kuroda identities. It looks like this one right here. So I'm going to convert that to a parallel capacitor and a different length of line. So this box is going to become this box, and then of course we'll continue to have C3 and ZA and CA and Z naught. So this one, when we do this conversion over this direction, we're going to end up with 1 over Z2, and this is going to be Z1. And now we need to figure out what Z1 and Z2 are for this case. So we can see that L2 is equal to Z2 over n, Z1 over n squared, and we can see that ZB is equal to Z2 over n squared. So let's write that down. So L2 is equal to Z1 over n squared, and ZB is equal to Z2 over n squared. So let's find out what n squared is. So n squared is equal to 1 plus Z2 divided by Z1, so I need to solve for each of these. So Z2 is going to be n squared, this is 1 plus n squared ZB, and Z1 is going to be n squared L2. My n squareds cancel out, so this is 1 plus ZB divided by L2. Now, we want to do our conversion, so we can see that this value right here needs to be Z1, and so we will just take Z1 equals L2 times this value of n squared that we'll get, and Z2 is going to be ZB times n squared. So the value of Z1 okay, so here are the values that I have for Z1 and Z2. And then the other thing that we need to know, we're going to now call these ZC, because this is our third, and then we're going to calculate CC, which is going to be 1 divided by Z2, which is, so that gives us a value for this C, which we're going to call CC, and the value for this impedance, which we're going to call ZC. Okay, great. We now have 3 parallel capacitors, but we still have 1 series inductor, LB. We're going to get rid of that by adding another length of line here, which also is going to have a characteristic impedance of 1, and then we're going to do the same transformation that we just did. Let's go to the next page. Okay, so let's do our last transformation. Right here, it's the same transformation we just did. That one looks like this, and we can see that Z0 is equal to Z2 divided by n squared, and that LB is equal to Z1 divided by n squared. So let's calculate n squared. This is going to be Z2 is equal to n squared Z0, and Z1 is equal to n squared LB. So n squared is equal to 1 plus Z2 divided by Z1, which is 1 plus n squared Z0 over n squared LB. The n squareds cancel out. This is 1 plus Z0 over LB. So here are all the values that we're going to get when we do this calculation. Okay, so I've done the calculations here, and n squared is 2.765. z2 becomes the same thing because z0 was 1, and z1 becomes half of that, 1.5666. I'm also going to calculate cd while I'm at it. That's the capacitance that's right here, and that's 1 over z2. So let's draw what our final circuit is. So in summary, here are the values of capacitance, and here are the values of impedance that we're going to use in our design. Now we need to convert them into stubs. Okay, so here's how we do the denormalization. To find the impedances of the stubs, I'm calling those ZS's, we take the characteristic impedance Z0, which is 50 ohms in this case, and we divide by the capacitance that we have in parallel. So the first stub is going to be 138, second stub 51, and so on. To find the impedances of the line, we just take the impedances that we had and we multiply them by 50. So we have the circuit that we saw on the previous page, CD, ZD, and so on, that we can now do as a series of stubs. Okay, here's the final design. We have four stubs. They have impedances ZSD, C, ZS3, and ZSA, separated by lines that have lengths that have impedances ZD, ZC, and ZA. Every one of these lengths, this is lambda by 8, and this distance is lambda by 8, so all of the lengths of all of these are lambda by 8. The next thing that you would do is put these values into a transmission line calculator, for microstrip perhaps, with a cutoff frequency of 2 gigahertz, and you'd be able to find the widths of all of these lines based on these impedances. Thanks for joining me for this example.